Good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining us. My name is Lucy Geller. I am a senior theater major at Pomona College, and I'll be the stage manager of our event tonight, Climate Change Theater Action 2020 at the Claremont Colleges. Our performance is approximately 75 minutes in length with no intermission. We are grateful for the support of the Pomona College Department of Theater and Dance, the Environmental Analysis Program at the Claremont Colleges, the Arctic Cycle, and EnviroLab Asia. After the reading, there will be a short talkback discussion with our special guest, playwright and Climate Change Theater Action co-founder Chantal Bilodeau. We invite you to join us for that. Before we begin, a land acknowledgement for the location of Pomona College in Claremont, California. With respect to their elders, past and present, we recognize the Gabrieleño Tongva and the Fernandinho Tutamviam peoples who are still here and who inspire us to lift up their cultures and tell their stories. We hope you will enjoy our performance. First, here is the play, There Are a Lot of Stories You Can Tell About Humanity by David Finnegan.
There are a lot of stories you can tell about humanity. Here's two of my favorites.
Humanity was born in the Rift Valley in Kenya. It spent its infancy and most of its childhood in East Africa.
It had siblings, other hominid species that grew up alongside, and who one by one passed away, mysteriously or not.
There was a moment, late in humanity's childhood, when it came close to expiring. 75,000 years ago, during the last ice age, the Toba volcano erupted, a huge eruption that blocked the sun from the sky for 3 years and locked the earth into a horrific deep freeze. Humanity lost all but 15,000 individuals living in the Ethiopian highlands. The species had a very tough time of it. It came very close to going extinct altogether.
That's my grandparents, yours, everyone you've ever met. All of us trace our ancestry back to that community of 15,000 people in the highlands.
After the weather warmed again, humanity spread out of Africa into Europe and the rest of the world.
And then, a few thousand years ago, the Ice Age ended. The species came out of its childhood and it began to develop very suddenly. Population growth, technological growth. It became rapidly stronger, more intelligent. You could say the species hit puberty.
But like a lot of adolescents, its emotional development hasn't caught up with its physical and mental growth.
As in, it hasn't yet learned to empathize and collaborate with others. It's still on occasion thoughtlessly cruel and abusive, still bewitched by material technology, still unconcerned about planning for the future.
And in order to make it to adulthood, humanity will need to survive what looks like it might be some pretty tempestuous teenage years.
Another story.
Imagine a ship sailing from the past into the future. We are the passengers on the ship. We are also the crew.
We have limited resources, and there are no other ships out there. We are completely on our own.
Every decision we make, every action we take, slightly alters our course.
For a long time, let's say the past 12,000 years, we were sailing in one direction at a steady speed, and that course seemed pretty safe.
About 200 years ago, give or take, we started to change course. We took on new passengers at an exponential rate, and we started accelerating in this new direction faster and faster.
Right now, we're in unfamiliar waters. As far as we know, no one's ever been here before.
There are some people who think we're steering into danger. If there's a safe operating space, we're not in it anymore. There's signs that we may have sailed into a hidden reef, and there are rocks ahead and around us that we cannot see. We could be about to rip a hole in our hull at any moment and start taking on water.
We can't turn around and go back the way we came. A ship with nearly 10 billion passengers. You can't just put it in reverse or do a U-turn.
We have to navigate through somehow. We have to pick our way between the rocks and make it back out to clear seas.
And if we get in trouble, if we hit a reef and start sinking in the middle of the ocean, there is no one coming to help us.
It Starts With Me by Chantal Bilodeau.
It starts with me, a woman, a sister, a mother.
It starts with me, a girl, a niece, a daughter.
It starts with me,
a student,
a scientist,
an elder.
Me.
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 A politician.
An environmentalist.
A writer.
It starts with me.
It starts with me.
It starts with me.
Because I may be young, but I can stand in front of world leaders and demand that they do their job.
Because I may be poor, but I can fight to address female well-being and ecological health together.
Because I may be marginalized, but I can draw upon indigenous traditional knowledge and heal the earth.
Because I may be inexperienced.
Ambitious.
Angry.
Religious.
And I may be just me.
But I've had enough of the patriarchy to call it what it is and dismantle it.
I've had enough of politicians' dysfunction to run for office and win.
I've had enough of capitalism.
Greed.
White supremacy.
Denialism.
To ignore those invested in the status quo and take matters into my own hands.
It starts with me.
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 Because I'm 14 times more likely to die in a natural disaster than a man.
Because I'm 4 times more likely to be a climate refugee than a man.
Because after a natural disaster, I am 300 times more likely to be abused by a man.
Because I'm vulnerable to toxins and pollutants.
Always.
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 To human trafficking.
Always.
Always.
To poverty, hunger, and death.
Always.
Always.
It starts with me.
It starts with me.
Because I'm willing to make sacrifices to reduce emissions.
Yes.
Yes.
Because I'm responsible for half of the global food production.
Yes.
Yes.
Because I'm inclined to ratify international environmental agreements.
Yes.
Yes.
Because I will no longer be abused.
No.
No.
Because I will no longer be silenced.
No.
No.
I will no longer be belittled, dismissed, discounted.
No.
No.
It starts with me.
It starts with me.
It starts with me.
It starts with me.
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 It starts with me.
Because without me, there's no salvation for anyone.
Or the planet.
Or the planet.
Layla Pines for the Wolf by Hassan Abdul Razak.
This is how the story goes.
Layla, your grandmother isn't well. I want you to take this cake and bottle of wine to her. Oh, and Layla, don't step off the path and leave things in the forest as you find them.
Yes, Mother.
But Layla was a liar. She not only veered off the path, she began to pluck the flowers and plants of the forest as she always does. This is where I enter the story. Good morning, Little Red Riding Hood.
Don't call me that, Wolf. I hate it when you call me that. My name's Layla.
Good morning, Layla. And where are you going so early in the morning?
To Granny's house.
And what's in that basket of yours?
Granny is ill. My stupid mother thought she could cure her with the cake.
And what's in the bottle you're drinking?
Pretty awesome Malbec. Wasted on the old hag, if you ask me. Want to sip?
I wouldn't mind a drop. I live on the island over there. It's where I was born. I crossed what was left of the frozen water that connects the island to the mainland here. Let me tell you, it's getting harder and harder to cross because of climate change.
Is this a sob story? Because I really don't have time for a sob story.
I don't suppose you could spare some of that cake.
Not a chance.
Are you heading to your grandmother's house? I could walk with you.
Not before I pick some more flowers.
For your grandma? How thoughtful.
Hell no. They're for me.
And so I leave Layla as she gets about clearing more of the forest, and I go to her grandma's house. I knock on the door.
Who's there?
A weary traveler. Grandma opens the door. She's got a gun. I didn't mean to scare you. I was just wondering if you've got any scraps I could eat. It's getting harder and harder to get here from my island. I'm famished.
I got nothing for a scrawny-ass wolf, except this bullet.
She fires the gun, which is old and rusty. The recoil knocks her off the feet. Her head smashes against the bed frame. She is dead as a doornail. I'm panicking, even though I had nothing to do with her death. Any minute, Layla would be here. I don't want her to be traumatized by the sight of her grandma's cracked head. I try to hide grandma under the bed. She's too big. In the cupboard, it's full of clothes and piles and piles and piles of plastic bags. I've got to hide her corpse before Layla gets here. What do? There's only one thing for it. And this is where things get a little weird. I eat grandma and put on her clothes.
Mother said straight ahead not to delay or be misled. I should have heeded her advice. But he seemed so nice, and he showed me things, many beautiful things that I hadn't thought to explore. They were off my path, so I never had dared. I had been so careful, I never had cared. And he made me feel excited, well, excited and scared.
Hello, Layla.
Hello, why was the door open?
Oh, it must have been the wind.
Oh, Grandma, what big ears you've got.
All the better to hear you with.
What big eyes you've got.
Oh, all the better to see you with.
What big hands you've got.
All the better to hug you with.
And, oh, Grandma, what a great, grim, ghastly mouth you've got.
All the better to kiss you with.
You're not my grandma, you're the big bad wolf.
And that's when she takes out her .44 Magnum and blows my brains out.
Layla, your grandmother isn't well. Take this cake and bottle of wine to her.
Yes, Mother.
Good morning, Layla. Where are you going so early in the morning?
To Granny's house.
And what's in the bottle you're drinking?
Want to sip?
Oh, yes, please.
Forget it.
I'm famished. It's getting hotter every year, which makes which means when the water freezes, it forms a much thinner ice sheet than in the past. It makes crossing from the island to the mainland tricky. You have to watch your step, it's exhausting.
Boring. I'm off to pick flowers.
You've got to stop destroying the forest. That's what's causing the ice to melt.
Let me tell you, I make some serious cha-ching out of these flowers.
Then at least give me a piece of that cake, please.
Get lost.
I go to her grandma's house.
Who's there?
A weary traveler. Grandma opens the door before that she has a chance to point her gun at me. I drop dead from hunger.
Grandma.
Hello, darling. Did you bring me cake and wine?
Did you kill the wolf?
I didn't touch him, I swear. He just dropped dead.
What are we going to do now? He's supposed to eat you, and then I kill him, and then the cycle starts again.
Well, he's dead anyways. Maybe if we wait a little?
It doesn't work like that. He has to be alive when I shoot him in the head. Then everything goes back to the start. Damn it, damn it, damn it. This means I'm stuck here forever.
Shoot me.
What?
Shoot me and free yourself.
I can't shoot you. You're my grandma.
You call me old hag behind my back. You think I don't know that?
I call you that because I love you, you stupid old thing.
Shoot me.
No.
Shoot me.
No.
The only way to save yourself, Layla.
And that's when Layla takes out her .44 for a magnum and blows grandma's brains out.
Layla, your grandmother isn't well. You gotta go and kill her.
Yes, mother.
Layla plucks the flowers as usual, but this time I don't show up because the water between the island and the mainland never froze. So she stays stuck in the forest, which is no longer a forest, just a clearing. She plucks and plucks until there is nothing left.
The last thing I hear is a cry from the island. It's the wolf.
I'm standing here for a body that cannot stand here. I'm speaking for the voice that is writing, that is Hannah. This body stands here for her body, as we all should with our bodies that can stand here, and for those that cannot. Coal was mined by hands, with soot under nails, a dark cramp cough, and the little sunny flicker of the canary in its cage. This body is standing here for a body that used to stand on stages, like this body does now, that used to dance to electro swing and jump into embraces and dig down into quarries and catacombs. This body is standing here for a body that 4 years ago found an abandoned coal cellar under the streets of Paris. Untouched for years, the walls didn't reflect the torchlight consumed by the rich blackness. The canary was used as a warning signal. She said, "Get the hell out, you're breathing poisoned air." She sent it with the envelope of her silent corpse. This body stands here for that body, sacrificed to send you a message, to keep you safe. For a body that lies in a bed, breathing through respirators, unable to open a window to feel the breeze, the skin of her body, the body feels the breeze for her body. This body stands in this public air for her body, that can no longer stand in public air or under public gaze. I'm standing here amongst you for that body, whose genes have mutated, developed a warning signal, a body whose white blood cells attack petrochemicals, treat them like an allergy, a poison. With a potentially fatal immune response, the canary thrashes its beak against the bars, claws, and scratches at the cheap gilding, her cells on a hair trigger, changing systems, pathways to explode at will. struck on a feedback loop until every single source of food and water and breath is lost to the rising tide of reactivity. A body whose throat swells up because her nurse accidentally wore eyeliner. A body swollen with hives from a piece of plastic. A body that can smell your laundry powder from across the street. Smell what you ate 3 days ago through your skin. Smell bacteria. This body stands here for a body that doesn't know if it's an evolution or an illness. She wants to ask me not to wear a scent when my body stands here for her. She hesitates. What kind of climate activist body would wear a scent? What kind of activist, when 90% of the chemicals that make up scent are petroleum delivered? She asks again, because the answer is most of us, unknowingly. In makeup, hair products, synthetic fabrics, synthetic leathers, moisturizers, clothing detergents, our bodies soaked and wrapped in fossil fuels. Because the media drives that tell us to ditch our straws don't let us know that washing synthetic fabrics in our home is one of the highest sources of microplastics in our oceans and our lungs. Because we are never told that our indoor use of personal care products and household cleaning supplies produces half of outdoor city air pollution, more than cars. The canary breaks out of the cage and yells, "Fuck you, capitalist coal junkies," and flies off into the sky. This body stands for those bodies that are changing into bodies that cannot stand here like this body. The 34% and rising of bodies that are noticeably injured by these scents and plastics and beautifiers we pretend we need, but we could be free in an instant. Up high, high, like a cloud, all the canaries are free of their cages, flashing bright yellow in the sun like a light. I stand here for her body, in my body that is breathing all the poisons with you, in the rain of yellow feathers tumbled down soft on your nose and eyelid. And the canaries are stripping off their wings. They say, never again will we be made to feel like our lives are lived for your profit. And dead on branches, they stand gloriously naked. We stand here for their bodies. The canaries have dipped their little beaks in soot and crawl. My body asks her body what it feels like. For her body to be so damaged by all the tiny personal choices of our day, her body tells me, my body, that she feels like the earth. So this body here also stands here for the earth that cannot stand here. It cannot speak to us, except through the envelope of silent corpses. The canaries drop themselves onto the bonnet of cars in New York, onto department stores in London, onto ferries full of tourists in Paris. Their bodies catch on the gliders of the Sydney Harbour Bridge. Talons tangle in the hair of Hitchcock heroines. Tiny pink blistering bodies full of chlorinated fountains. And I fill my lungs with poisoned air to shoot bullets of words through this poisoned air because my destruction will not be silent. In their death rattle, the canaries say, this is the message we send with our bodies. We are not your warning signals anymore. We do not need a warning signal if you just stay the fuck out of the coal mines. Stay the fuck out of the coal mines. This body is here amongst their bodies and also stands for their bodies and the bodies that cannot stand here. Some say struggling, not quite dead, on the hot tarmac, wing bones broken, beak shattered, and tiny molecules are placed around their ankles as police gently scoop them up to be back in cages. The words are washed from their bodies. They are to send a new message. As their new cages are hung high outside the front shops and town halls, their broken bodies on display, a warning. By sudden silent stares seem to say something different than what their captors wish. Their caged bodies to be saying in the corpse of the canaries that were not scooped up by the policemen with their gently violent hands. are treading under shoes, burst under the pressure of car tires, and fried slowly in the sun. And you walk over that red smudge on the footpath. You have your car windshield replaced. A workman cleans your pool. And they are almost forgotten in the silence of their absence, forgetting also that their silence is the warning. And I will go home to my home that is not a cage. I won't notice the air freshener on the bus and the hidden petroleum ink embedded in my recycled toilet paper, and the plastics in the product in my hair, or the scent that I did or didn't wear today when the body I stood for asked me not to.
Failed Experiment by Vitor Hatoba.
There's no hope this time. As Director of Research Division for New Species, I must recognize that this planet is moving straight towards self-destruction.
What leads you to this tragic conclusion, sir?
This dominant species we put out there, they can't harmonize with any other beings. It's obvious. They simply poison every environment they inhabit.
But they are a very young species, sir.
The planet is running out of time.
We too were a very young species once. We needed time to evolve, sir. Everything takes time, sir.
Rookie, I respect your enthusiasm. I really do. But they have enough intellectual awareness by now to identify their problems, problems that they themselves have created, and find solutions. They're clearly conscious of the consequences of their actions.
But with all due respect, sir, we shouldn't give in to pessimism.
Sometimes I wonder if you ever listen to anything I say, rookie.
I've been learning from you all my young life, sir. Centuries listening to you. The new species is gaining awareness of what it must do. The numbers show it.
But will they ever do something about it?
Maybe they just need more trust from us, sir.
It's going too slow. Some of them are very enlightened. We know they're trying, but they aren't enough of them. And they don't have the power to address all the shit.
Oh, sir, you just said a bad word.
That's how upset I am. Don't you get it? What these few individuals do isn't enough. They destroy way more than they preserve. They drink water, a very simple formula, H2O. And even though it's essential for their survival, they pollute and poison it knowingly. They put poison on their own food. Tell me, rookie, what other species have we created that has poisoned its own food?
Not a single one, sir.
This is a failed experiment.
There are Homo sapiens discussing these issues right now, sir, all over the planet. Sir, I understand your frustration, but we weren't that different from them when we started off. We weren't better than them.
I know that, rookie. You're impossible.
Should I take that as a compliment, sir?
Whatever, rookie. Whatever. Listen, we gave them autonomy. They think, they write, they have concepts, they can even achieve more than us. Their planet is perfect for life. Every species we have thrown out there has found a way. But this one, all it cares about is money, power, and money. And the few enlightened individuals, what happens to them? Put in jail, killed, and exiled. It's useless.
Sir, have you ever thought about an intervention? Like we go there and point them in the right direction?
Be honest with me. Do you think they would understand that it's for their own good?
I'm not sure, sir.
And Rookie, the way they are, I'm not sure it would be wise to reveal our existence. They can find our planet. We're very close. It has been thousands of years since we've had any weapons. How will we defend ourselves?
Sir, can I propose something that could bring some excitement into this dire situation we find ourselves in?
What?
I'll bet.
Oh yeah, baby. Let's go for it, Rookie.
The planet is our responsibility, but this solar system is not the corporation's main concern right now. Am I right? The corporation even talks about cutting our budget and shutting down operations.
I'm listening.
I'll sign the reboot protocol, and...
Are we talking?
Yes, sir.
My dear and beloved.
Oh, yes, sir. I'm afraid so.
Dinosaurs? We're talking dinosaurs?
We're talking dinosaurs, sir.
What's happening to my face, Rookie?
That's a smile, sir. You're very happy.
Dinosaurs?
I bet that humans will evolve and survive and prevail. They'll survive, find a way. The few who see and understand what's necessary will be embraced by the rest of humankind and carve a path towards light and wisdom.
Oh, Rookie, and to think I once was idealistic like you. They'll disappear because they're too smart for their own good. And we reboot. Reboot protocol. My two favorite words side by side. That's the bet. And then we return to my dear and beloved dinosaurs. A project that, by the way, should never have been discontinued.
They were very short on arms, sir.
That's no excuse.
They could never write and create languages with those tiny fingers, sir.
That was my first project. Give me a break. Fingers. Fingers are something new.
I know, sir. I didn't mean to upset you.
I know, Rookie. And what do you want if a miracle happens and you win this bet?
A dinner at Galactic Star, sir.
That's a very expensive place. You sure know how to make a bet.
Do I feel a shade of doubt in your voice, sir?
Don't be sillier than you already are, Rookie. You should know that Galactic Star is way overrated. I hate that place.
Do we have a bet, sir?
Oh, yeah, baby.
So let the bet begin, sir.
Earth Duet by E.M. Lewis.
Everything.
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 Ripe red strawberries.
Golden.
Golden.
Peaches dripping.
Syrup down your
chin.
Blueberries.
Blueberries.
Things that are
fruit.
Things that are
wheat. Also.
Also.
Things that are
tall elephants and
trees.
Fir, cherry, oak.
Things that are
tall.
Fathers and
sunflowers,
skyscrapers,
mountains,
everything
goes.
Finite.
We are
finite.
All the people,
all the things
we can't hold on to,
we want to hold on to,
we want so badly to hold on to.
Slippery
time.
Tick, tick, tick.
Time.
Tick, tick, tick.
Slipping
through our fingers.
makes it so hard to think about endings.
I have trouble thinking about endings.
Endings are hard.
We like beginnings better.
Babies.
Baby showers.
Marigold seeds.
Chocolate chip cookie dough.
Sunrise.
Tick, tick, tick.
Sunset.
We want so badly to hold on to.
Time.
Each other.
Memories.
Things we love.
World we love.
Going.
Things are always
going.
Grieve their
going.
What can we do?
What can we do?
What can we do?
What can we do?
Change the way the world works?
No.
Change the way the world works?
No.
Change the way.
Change the way.
Change the way we work upon the world.
Change from short-term thinking to.
To long-term thinking.
We've been cutting off the branch we're sitting on.
We've been pretending all the resources.
All the resources.
All the beautiful, useful resources.
Will last forever.
So we've used them and.
Used them.
Used them.
Finite.
This world is.
Finite.
Everything here is.
Finite.
Things run out.
There are a lot of people here.
Here on this earth.
Using.
Wasting.
Not thinking about tomorrow.
Tick, tick, tick.
Scary to think about.
Tomorrow.
Endings.
Scary to think about.
But we don't.
So we've acted like.
Everything ends.
And everyone.
Will last.
Forever. But it won't.
Not
the way. The way we're going. Is it possible for us to
change the narrative?
Is it possible for us to
change the world?
What is our power here?
What do we want our power to be?
Is it possible for us to change the way the
world works?
The way we work upon the world?
Can we fix things we've broken?
Do we want to?
Do we think it's important to?
Do we think it's our responsibility to?
Do we think it's someone else's responsibility?
Anyone else's responsibility to?
Change the world.
Or do we think it's ours?
Do we think the time to change?
Is some other time?
Or now?
Do we care about the world we live in?
Do we want it to be around tomorrow?
And tomorrow.
And tomorrow after that.
After we come and go.
After our children come and go.
After their children come and go.
If we even have children.
It's not about children.
It's about all children.
Having a world tomorrow.
We have the power to make that happen.
How?
Change the way we work upon the world.
Let's change the way we work upon the world.
Let's institute some
long-term thinking.
Let's take care of what we've got.
Let's be good stewards of the earth.
Of this beautiful earth.
Of this sweet blue planet earth.
Right now, it's the
only one we've got. Right now, it's the
only one we've got.
Six polar bears fell out of the sky this morning. By Alistair Emerson.
And then I said to my cleaning lady, if everyone at my country club makes $500,000 a year, it can't be that hard.
Check out the breaking news. It's unbelievable.
residents of Los Angeles have awoken to a shocking and unprecedented event. According to eyewitness accounts, 6 polar bears fell out of the sky this morning. Despite falling from the sky, they miraculously landed unharmed and were last seen walking away in search of food.
The greenies are going nuts and blaming climate change. Someone is going to have to do the press briefing and tell the public everything is okay. Just another day in paradise.
Damn it. How can we spin this one?
We could go with no cause for alarm. It was a weather balloon.
Weather balloons go up. The polar bears fell down out of the sky.
A weather balloon malfunction?
Or satellite returning to Earth that broke into 6 polar bear-shaped pieces. Yeah, that's good. But what about any eyewitnesses who saw the 6 bears walk off in search of food?
Unfortunately, the 6 polar bear-shaped pieces landed on 6 unlucky cows grazing near the city center. The cows were dazed by the falling space debris, but all were unharmed and walked away in search of food. In the confusion, drunken locals reported they saw polar bears.
Plausible.
Agreed.
Problem. One of the eyewitnesses posted photos of a polar bear walking away from the crash site. Already has 1.3 million likes.
Okay. One of the polar bear-shaped pieces of the fallen satellite crashed into a visiting circus and landed on a polar bear cage, freeing the surprised but lucky polar bear. The circus was relieved to learn that their most precious bear, Mr. Fluffles, was unhurt and looked forward to reuniting the bear with its dearest friend, Bongo, the 3-legged elephant who has been crying all night since the polar bear went exploring around town.
Plausible.
Agreed.
What? Apparently, International Polar Bear Rescue already has people on the ground here with a video camera and just uploaded videos of 4 more of the bears wandering the city, climbing into dumpsters, snuffling through rubbish bins, and one of them just in a poodle. 2.8 million hits on YouTube.
Okay. Excited and disorientated by the noise of falling pieces of polar bear-shaped satellites, a startled group of teenagers who were out selling Girl Scout cookies to raise money for an orphanage and were dressed as polar bears became confused and jumped into dumpsters to escape the noise. When they emerged, the youngest member of the group, Little Sally,
who recently gave one of her kidneys to a complete stranger,
realized she had dropped a contact lens during the commotion and asked the others in the group to help find it.
They combed the cold, lonely city streets, even searching through rubbish bins for the precious contact lens,
which used to belong to Little Sally's dead grandmother and had been a gift to Little Sally on her deathbed.
The teens were later surprised to learn that the International Polar Bear Rescue may have inadvertently filmed them and are seeking damages for use of their images without permission.
Plausible?
Agreed.
Son of a biscuit! What is wrong with these people? A helpful local has been befriended the last of the fallen bears and is taking it home, giving it food, shelter, and a family who love it dearly. They will be appearing on a special episode of Oprah Winfrey at 8 p.m. tonight for the tell-all story of a bear that fell from the sky.
We could discredit the bear, talk about how it was an alcoholic, seal pup murdering savage, and fell out of a plane during a drunken bender while it was trying to snort coke off the air hostess.
Plausible.
Agreed.
Or maybe we could just tell the truth. The greenies are right. Admit that things are utterly out of control. The polar bears were flung halfway around the world by severe weather events caused by man-made climate change, so rampant and so ridiculous that anything is possible.
Come on, Madam Press Secretary, you've had a stressful day. I think you need to go have a lie down and a nice cup of tea. Maybe some soothing music, and we can buy you a new puppy and some new pajamas with pictures of rabbits on them.
Residents of Los Angeles have awoken to a shocking and unprecedented event. A satellite containing poems written by children from around the world who were lost in the forest as babies and raised by wolves was returning to Earth, but unfortunately broke up on re-entry and crashed into government buildings. During the freak accident, a rogue piece of satellite smashed through a wall, landing in the office of the press secretary, killing six visiting orphan polar bears and decorated war hero, Madam Press Secretary. Moments before tragedy struck, she was preparing to host a dinner in honor of the left-handed orphan polar bears. Donald Trump has honored the late press secretary by promising that Mexico will pay for the wall.
Plausible.
Gaia by Hiro Kanagawa.
Here, now, in the face of this, it is hard not to think of Gaia, our once heavenly host, heaving like a beast with sickness, lurching between fever and chills as her orbit fails, falters, the resplendent plumage she wore just yesterday of savannas and jungles, reefs and archipelagos, all bleached and blighted now, Maine, eczema, while her rivers, her oceans, her waters of life acidify, choke, bloom with red death.
In the face of this, it is hard not to think of Armageddon. Four horsemen gathering the armies to the mountain, the lake of fire. Seven angels with seven plagues, seven bulls filled with the wrath of God. Water turns to blood. Babylon mounts the beast who once was, now is not, and yet will come. In the face of this, it's hard not to think of the big questions. Is there a God, a loving creator, salvation, resurrection? Is there transcendent escape to the white light, the pearly gates, or does karma await? And what cosmic retribution befits our sentient race, who we who defiled and destroyed our one blue home? In the face of this, it's hard not to think of lemmings, fruit flies in a jar, parasites who kill their host.
Here, now, the ice has melted, the sea has risen, the sun bakes, and the earth splits like a bloated carcass. Gaia belongs again to ants and beetles and watery tubes of nucleic acid, who burrow their way through the thawing corpses of the Pleistocene.
Is this hell? Surely heaven, for nature liberated from the tyranny of us. Hell only if there are human souls trapped in this prison of darkness and slime, sentenced to an eternity of self-revulsion as they eat shit and breed without hope or love or consequence.
Where is humanity's heaven, then? Was there a rapture for we the holy and we the conscientious? Did we the recycling, hybrid driving, pipeline protesting, yoga posing righteous ascend to an astral plane of pure energy to dot the firmament with our virtuous starlight? Then again, what is starlight? The stars themselves are raging infernals of elemental hellfire and self-immolation, isolated from one another by lights, light years of absolute cold and emptiness.
So, hell, either way then, leaving only the one heaven, Gaia, our home, our garden, from which we should have never needed nor sought deliverance.
Let us return to her then.
If only as ashes and dust.
Let us feed her soil with our crumbled bodies.
Let her seeds root in the bones of our skulls, our ribs, our loins.
Let pale shoots shoulder their way sunward.
Through the same voids where once our eyes gazed with wonder and delight.
Let the air be fragrant with the kiss of soft green things.
Let the forest sigh with the cool breath of their leaves.
Let stamens and pistils tremble with the sweetness of dew and sap.
And let Gaia cry and moan with fecund life.
Here, now.
Let winged creatures startle and take flight.
Let dark hunters howl in reply.
Let all life breathe as Gaia breathes.
swell, ebb, flow, recede.
Sleep, rest, die.
Rise, fall, begin again.
We who were once the blessed, the chosen.
And now are not, yet will be again.
When we return to Gaia on that eternal day.
Oh, how we will live in the garden.
Oh, how we will live.
Oh, how we will live.
Please give a virtual round of applause for our actors. Thank you for joining us tonight, everyone. And thank you, Art, to our actors. It was so wonderful to see you guys do your performance and really bring it tonight. Special thank you to Mark Los Huertos from Environmental Analysis and EnviroLab Asia for attending tonight. And thank you again to the Environmental Analysis Program of the Claremont Colleges, the Arctic Cycle, and EnviroLab Asia for joining with the theater department to put on this event. And now, please join me in welcoming playwright and climate change theater action co-founder, Chantal Bilodeau.
Hi, thank you. Congratulations, everyone. This was a really wonderful performance, and I'm happy to have been able to attend. I'm very impressed with what you've been able to do despite the limitations. I can only imagine how hard it must have been to rehearse each in your individual rooms, to not be able to, you know, feel each other's energy, and even to perform and not be able to know who's on the other side of the screen, who's looking, how people are reacting. I think you have to be commended for working through all of these difficulties and still presenting something that is wonderful. And I love the images that you found to put behind you as backdrops. They really help set the stage and give a sense of where we are. I wonder if, I would be happy, I would love to hear from you, anyone who wants to jump in, how the process was, you know, how did you choose the plays? How was it rehearsing? Just to hear a little bit about what happened behind the scene to make this performance tonight.
Yeah, does anyone from the class want to jump in? I can also speak to it. Hi, I'm Lucy. I am the attached writing partner for this course, actually. It's a ID1, which is our freshman seminar at Pomona called Theater in the Age of Climate Change. And we actually had a really fun rehearsal process. We met yesterday, at least I was there yesterday, and then today, briefly before the performance, and we did, you know, a couple run-throughs. I think it was a mix of like crowdsourcing for the backgrounds, and the students also had really fun ideas. Shout out to Salim for, and I believe Eric for having the alien thing that they added. And that was a lot of fun. So it really was a group effort. And, you know, I don't know if all of these students have performed before or acted before. So it was really fun to see them get to do that. I would like to invite anyone in the audience. Oh, great. We already have a question to type in any questions they may have for Chantal to answer, if that's all right with you, Chantal.
Yes, of course.
Perfect. Well, we already have one from Gigi. Thanks, Gigi. And she wanted to know, how has the meaning of It Starts With Me shifted in the wake of electing the first woman and a woman of color as vice president?
Oh my God, I didn't even think about that. Thank you, Gigi, for that question. I think it's even more powerful. I mean, now it feels like, you know, if I say it starts with me, there's somebody in a position of power who can back me, right? For every woman who wants to say it starts with me, they have someone to look up to, they have someone they can trust, and they, I don't know, but I certainly feel a lot more represented, certainly than I have in the last 4 years. But also, you know, I'm very happy Joe Biden was elected, but if I want to talk about feeling personally connected and feeling represented, it's really with Kamala Harris more than with Joe Biden. So yeah, I think hopefully, you know, hearing this play, knowing that we're going to have a woman in the White House is going to resonate more strongly.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you. So we have another question from Marcos Huertos of EnviroLab and the Environmental Analysis Department. And he says, I think the issues regarding patriarchy and the environment are really powerful. Could the actors and the playwright, Chantal, tell us how that reading felt for you and what you think about that process?
Yeah, I would love to hear from the actors.
Come on, guys, don't be shy.
I wasn't there, so I can't speak to how the process was.
Camille, Sierra, Sabrina, I believe. Lucy, maybe, were you in it? Mai? Hi, Mai. Do you want to tell us a little bit about how it, you were in this one, right? You were in the one I wrote. Can you talk a little bit about that?
So I think part of me was always so impressed that the play is very powerful. I think Zoom took a bit away from it, but in the original play, we would all be chanting together and the audience would be able to chant with us if they so wish. So I think that's like a very powerful aspect, just the building of energies and people coming together in unity, speaking aloud their message. And so I thought it was really powerful to work on it, even though it was on Zoom, we couldn't really all chant at once, for example, but still we kind of develop a different system when we each take turn and emphasize one upon each other. And I thought that was really cool.
Yeah, just to add, I thought there were some exciting, that there are challenges with Zoom and there were some exciting opportunities with Zoom. I really loved the decision to, you know, start with videos off and just hear the voices, and then they come on and they have their masks on. I thought that was a really fun addition, and it was cool to see what, you know, conversely, like some of the new things you can do with this format. Would you like to speak to, you know, the process of writing it or seeing it performed and like the impact for you?
Yeah, when I wrote it, I knew that women are disproportionately impacted, especially in poorer countries, by climate change. So I was looking for some data to back that up. You know, I had heard about it, but then I stumbled upon this website, which I list in the play, which is called We Can. And it has all these statistics about how women are impacted. And so I wanted to find a way to put that into the play, you know, just so we would hear it. But also the theme for that year was lighting the way. So it was about putting forward or highlighting climate heroes, climate warriors. And I wanted, even though there's these statistics that say how, you know, difficult it is for women, I wanted to, at the same time, to elevate them, not present them as victims, but present them as, you know, women who are fighting and are trying to make their way and have something to offer. So that was kind of the impetus behind the play. And seeing it performed, you know, I have seen it live a few times, I think, last year. And it's been different. I actually really liked how it was adapted for Zoom. When it's done live, you never know how much the audience is gonna get into it, because there's a, in the stage directions, it says at some point, like get the audience to, like the, I'm sorry, the actors are clapping and stomping, and then they're trying to get the audience to follow, which of course you can't do on Zoom. And depending on the audience responses, you know, it can fall flat or it can really lift up. But taking that out, I like how the repetition was used instead to, in this case, to try to build a little bit of a momentum. So I thought that was very well done.
Awesome. Okay, we have another question. Oh, we have two more questions. Thank you everyone for sending in your questions. Keep going. If you have more, put them in the chat. And this is from Teddy Rodriguez Velez, and he wanted to know, were any of the participants motivated to research on their own anything that was mentioned in the plays? And has it changed the manner in which they behave? So I'm gonna open it up to our lovely students. Does anyone wanna talk about the impact these plays have had on them? Salim, do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, I just, so even if we can't like perform these in real life, just reading the plays, they really make you like help rethink about this whole environmental issues one more time. And specific to answer Professor Rodriguez's question, like from my experience, if I understood the question correctly, me and Eric for the failed experiment, we researched on like a video about the Coneheads going on Family Feud, so we would like make our accent like our alien accents better. So yeah, that like we did a couple of like some researches for our plays. And also, I think that I just want to mention this, these plays have really like helped us as a class to become like more of a like a really close class. I think this this event brought us closer a lot, especially out of class. We have like a group that we talk on. So I just think that these plays were really helpful in both like bringing us together and also understanding the like the serious problems that we face, like the environmental issues. So
awesome, thank you. Would anyone else be interested in sharing? Just a quick sec.
And well done on the accent, by the way, the for the aliens. It was very convincing.
That was fun, you guys. I really enjoyed it. Zaid, do you want to speak about your experience?
I just wanted to add that like many of these plays we've already studied in class, which I felt like we have, it kind of like hit home because we like talked about them, we studied them, and now I remember like some of the plays were like, oh, we wish we could act in this or present this one. So it kind of felt like, you know, I think it's nice at the end of the semester to present something you've studied and you've kind of grown to like understand more. And also like every one of us chose their plays or like sent in a selection of the plays they wanted to be in. So like everyone I felt was, you know, it felt like every play related to someone somehow, which I found really, really nice as well.
Oh, wonderful. Yeah, just jumping off of that, because I've had the pleasure of being able to read all of their essays this semester, and they've actually, a number of them have written about the plays that they performed tonight. So they've really engaged with these plays like in performance and also in an academic setting. And so it's been fun to, cause I didn't, some like six polar bears fell out of the sky this morning. A number of students wrote about that play, but I actually hadn't read it. And so it was really fun to see them act out this thing that a lot of them had really spent a lot of time thinking about, like the rhetorical strategies in the play and the ways in which the playwright might have tried to encourage the audience to take action with regard to this issue. So yeah, it's been a lot of fun, and they've really been very thoughtful in the way they've engaged with these works, which I've been really impressed by. Do you want to jump in?
Yeah, I have a question actually for the actors. The way the plays are written, when we commissioned the plays, we asked the writers to write a few sentences at the very beginning to explain their inspiration for the plays. And so I'm wondering how that's received, like whether you find that helpful, if it helps you like think bigger than if you had just had the play without the explanation. So I would be curious to hear what you thought about that.
Anyone? Yes. Camille and Sabrina, don't leave, come back. You can totally, I would love to hear what you have to say, but why don't we start with Camille?
Yeah, I thought the intro to the plays were really helpful, especially since like you can't interact with it in like a formal theater setting. So having it be online, you kind of use that information and interpret it in your own way, if that makes sense. Like you use that, but you really use it to like bounce off to your own like personal interpretations of what you think the play means.
Great. Thank you.
Yeah, Sabrina, do you want to talk about that? Hi again.
So for the project that Lucy was talking about, I wrote about Canary, and I think having that intro, she writes about both the things she talked about in the play with the petrochemicals, but also to give it context about who the author is and the struggles that she goes through. They're talked about in the play, but having that section at the top that even if it's not necessarily explicitly stated, you have the opportunity to research about the playwright and learn more about her, which gives a deeper understanding to the play and the metaphor of the canary.
Thank you. It's really nice to hear, because I think at least when I was studying playwriting, I think for a long time there was this thinking that we needed to separate the author from the play. You know, you study the work only, and whoever the author is a different thing. But I kind of like to bring them together and to consider that who the person is as like has something to bear on what the work is. So I'm glad that the personal statements are useful.
Yeah, that's so funny for me to hear, because one would think that the two are kind of like inextricably linked because the play comes out of the play, right? Interesting. So we do have another question from Gigi. Thank you, Gigi. She wants to know if you can tell us anything about Climate Change Theater Action 2021.
Let's see. I can tell you that we have pretty much finalized the list of playwrights, the 50 playwrights who are going to write the plays. And some of the emails inviting them have gone out. So we're starting the process. The theme will be announced at the beginning of 2021. So I'm not gonna tell you what that is yet. And what else can I tell you? There's going to be a few other things that are part of the events that we usually do, which is commissioning the plays and having them present, having people present them in the fall. But we're also going to do a speaking series to introduce some of the themes, some of the ideas that are part of the theme, and that will start in January and will go until May. So all of these announcements will be coming within a month or so.
Oh, exciting. So stay tuned for that, everyone.
And one more thing. The book, the anthology that contains all of the 2019 plays is almost there, almost. It's been delayed so many times, but it's almost ready. So I think in a week, there'll be an announcement, and that book will be available both on print and as an ebook for purchase.
Oh, that's so exciting. And with the holidays coming up, if anyone wants a climate change related or a theater related gift, keep that in your brain. So I want to encourage people, if they have any more questions, to go ahead and type them into the chat. But in the meanwhile, if anyone in our company, any of the students, or also Gio or Jim, if you have a question that you'd like to ask Chantal, I'd also like to open it up to you. So give everyone a second to think about that.
And while people are thinking, I want to say congratulations again to the students. I know I met some of you when I came and visited Jim's class. And so it was nice to see familiar faces again. And it's nice to see the journey that you've taken with these plays, you know, from going from studying them to performing them. It's really wonderful.
Yeah, awesome. So it looks like there don't seem to be more questions. So I'm going to leave you with just one question that I think will be a great note. Yes, Chantal, thank you so much for being here. So despite widespread climate activism throughout the world, climate change does remain a significant challenge. So I was just wondering what you think, and how you think we as theater makers can find hope for the future and continue to fight this threat.
Well, the fact that we have a new election, a new administration in the US is huge cause for hope, even though at the moment is cautious hope. Yeah. Hopefully come January, the cautious will be going away and we can just really be hopeful. I think the fact that more and more of us are taking this problem seriously and are wanting to get involved is cause for hope. And I, as theater makers, anyone in the arts, we have such a huge role to play that is undervalued, I think. The more this issue can become part of the culture, the more we can tell the stories around it, the more we can make it part of our lives and learn to live with it, adapt, and then do the best we can to not let it get worse, the better off we'll be. And I say to people all the time, unfortunately, most of the stories we hear in mainstream media are stories of failure. So disasters, policy failure, you know, you hear, it's so much more dramatic to hear something being destroyed than to hear about something being built. So we hear all of the stories of the things we're losing, and those are very real and we have to deal with them, but we don't hear enough about the little victories and even the big victories. So, you know, engaging all of the storytellers of the world, and that's us, to lift up those stories, I think is very important and is gonna pay off in the long term.
Okay, yeah. We actually have a follow-up question from Mark. He was wondering about what can folks in maybe rural areas where there maybe isn't a lot of like access to theater, like what do you have any ideas about what they can do for the future?
Yeah, if you're talking about stories specifically, you can tell stories any number of ways, right? You can meet outside with a mask 6 feet apart from each other, yeah, and tell stories to each other. You can, you know, you don't have to have a formal theater with a stage and all the trappings that go with that. Like, there's any way you can meet somebody in a grocery store and say, hey, and, you know, exchange stories. We do it all the time without thinking about it. So if you bring, without being preachy or without like wanting to force your opinions and your what you believe it on other people, you can bring up the subject and just engage in conversation and see what comes up and be willing to listen and be willing to exchange. And that's already a huge step.
I love that. Well, thank you so much for being here tonight, Chantal. And thank you everyone again for coming. Congratulations to our actors. Thank you to Professor Taylor and Professor Ortega. And I hope everyone has a wonderful evening.
Thank you. Congratulations. Thank you for having me.
Thank you. Good night, everyone.